I'm Crystal Moore, the Doctor from Doctor Who Velocity. And you are listening to Mark Who 42.
Welcome to Mark Who 42's Hooniverse. Did I say Hooniverse? Yeah, I guess I did. Mark Who 42's Universe is the name of our show. I'm your host, Mark Baumgarten, and with me today are...
Vicky Jakubowski.
Hi, Vicky.
Hi there.
Did you enjoy your TARDIS ride yesterday?
I did.
I'm glad. We also have the Type 50.
Zion Quiros.
And Zion is definitely inferring that he's better than our Type 40.
Faster.
Faster?
Faster, stronger, and gets places where they're supposed to be.
Oh, I thought you were going to do the $6 million man thing. Faster, we will rebuild. No. So, folks, if you're wondering, why weren't they on Subspace Radio Network? We're taking a break from them. We're taking a little hiatus because we want to do... some shows. We don't want to get ourselves tied down in weekly shows, and that's where we were there. We're going to do our best to keep you entertained and informed on MarkWho42s.com, on Audible, on Apple, on Google, on Pandora Radio, everywhere, all the podcast platforms around the world. And we are talking, well, you know, one of our best topics that we used to talk about in 2012 consistently. Doctor Who. Yes, the 60th anniversary season of Doctor Who is started. We've got three specials, and we're recording this on Sunday the 26th. Yesterday on the 25th, we got the Star Beast, right, guys?
Yes.
And we're definitely going to review the Star Beast, but before we do, there's some things that happened before in this celebration. A week ago last Friday, there was the Children in Need telethon, and that always goes well. They raised buku amount of money for that, and I'm glad.
Wonderful.
And they do a lot of different skits and comedy things and stuff throughout it based on television shows that BBC does. And they did one, oh, they had to, with Doctor Who. I mean, since Russell's been there, when he was there in the first time, every year there was something. There was something again starring David Tennant. So, Vicky, why don't you tell everyone a little, and this is spoilers, guys. If you haven't seen it, I'm sorry. Go to YouTube. Go to YouTube
here.
And watch this. So, Vicky, tell us a little about the plot of Destination Skaro.
You've got Davros, and he's created the Daleks, but they don't have a name yet. It's really important. There's no name yet. And he's got this other little mad scientist with him named Castavillian.
I love Castavillian.
who are you gonna
cast? A villain.
What other name could you have for a British villain other than Castavillian?
Yeah.
And you know, you just kind of think that it's like someone wrote that down and said, okay, we'll fill it in with a real name later. But then someone goes, I don't know, that sounds funny. Let's leave it. And so they're like, okay. And because someone somewhere started giggling and they kept it.
Yeah.
But
RTD giggles to himself a lot. RTD must giggle to himself a lot.
Come on. We all do. Let's just be honest.
Yeah.
But not everyone realizes, unless they watched, especially early Daleks, there was always kind of an internal and external joke about the way that the Daleks were built. And so when you see this Dalek, and he's got this massive, cool arm, it's got a grabber on it, it's got all this cool stuff, everything you think a weapon of mass destruction should have. And Mr. Castavillian has kind of come up with a name, and he's trying to make it be a anagram of their name, which is Kaled, K-A-L-E-D. And so he's trying to come up with all these names. So now Davros walks off, and in, bam, comes the TARDIS in the most hilarious fashion, because we've seen it happen before. Usually the TARDIS comes in gracefully. This was not a graceful landing. This is probably one of the least graceful landings. And what does it do? It busts one of the hands off the Dalek. And of course, out walks David Tennant, and he goes, "Oh my God, what is this? What is this Dalek doing here?" And the guy goes, "Ooh, Dalek, that's good, right?" Dalek, he goes, "You know, why aren't you trying to exterminate? Ooh, exterminate, that's good. I should write that down." And
doctor's giving everything away. In fact,
I know,
becoming,
the doctor is
the true genesis of the Dalek.
And then he says that, and he says, yeah, "Genesis of the Dalek." And I wasn't here.
I didn't say that.
I am dying of hysterics because I'm thinking Genesis of the Daleks, and you know, it's like, aha, the doctor is the genesis of the Daleks. And then everything is going wrong. He's broken off the arm. Oh my God, hilarity ensues. He says, "Hang on, I can fix that." So he runs into there. I actually turned to my husband and I said, yeah, "I know what's going to happen next."
Of course you did.
I'm going to tell you, I know exactly what's going to happen next. Sure enough, he comes up with the plunger.
Yeah.
Because listen, the BBC did not have a lot of money. It was a children's show back in the 60s. Mm-hmm. And at the time, they did what they could. And everyone's always said, why do Daleks have plungers for arms? What's scary about a plunger?
We now know.
It was thanks to the doctor. And so he comes on, he shoves it in there. And I'm just dying. I am dying in my seat. And I'm just crying. And in walks Davros, and he's looking at it. And Mr. Castavillian is like, uh-oh, I'm dead. And Davros goes, "Oh, I like it." And I'm like, nah.
Yeah. God. It was really a good story. Very funny.
It's only a few minutes. You have to watch it, because you will die laughing. Because every character, it's played very straight. It's hilarious. There are so many inside jokes. You could have only been watching Doctor Who since it's been New Who. Mm-hmm. And you will catch still so many inside jokes.
Yeah.
And you just die. And I'm sorry. I loved every second of it. And I want to say,
you know how many seconds there were of it? You know how many seconds there were of
it? Was it even 10 minutes?
How many?
No, it was 4 minutes, 54 seconds.
Oh, good Lord.
That's all it was.
That's all it was.
And it felt much. Yeah. That's all it was.
It was so well done.
Yeah. Interesting note, Nicholas Briggs did the voice of the Daleks as usual, but he also did the voice of Nidor from the original Genesis of the Daleks, because the gentleman who played them is no longer with us. And Davros was actually played by Julian Bleach, who has been playing Davros since 2005, since the New Who. He's been, and the fact that he's no longer in his life support machine that he's standing.
Yeah.
You know, Julian gets the, you know, BMC. It was weird seeing Julian Bleach without all that makeup on and sitting down and stuff.
It was actually kind of cool to see him in the original Colin uniform.
Yeah,
because you think about it, it was also kind of the genesis of Davros when you think about it.
They did a genesis of the Davros in Big Finish. They did I Davros, or CDs that came out giving the origins of Davros. But this is a good, because people don't know Big Finish doesn't have as many viewers as Children in Need, so this is a new thing for them. I guess it is the genesis of Davros. I guess you're right.
And it just, you know, we all need a laugh.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, after the week I had, it was great. And I think that with people dealing with, you know, in this country with Thanksgiving, it's always a stressful week for everybody everywhere. I don't care how well you prepare, plan. Mm-hmm. Family is tough.
Yeah.
No matter how much you love them, and no matter how easy you try to make Thanksgiving, it still seems to be a stressful time. So, I mean, watch it. It is hilarious. And I have to watch it again. I actually watched it twice. I have to watch it again because I gotta watch it again.
Oh, and Barnaby Edwards, who we've had on our show before, took his place, as he's been doing for many years, as the Dalek operator.
Ooh.
It's Barnaby inside that Dalek. I know children need raise a lot of money. It worked for a lot of people. It worked for me. But Zion, there was some controversy on this. Did you want to bring anything up?
Well, because ROTD said that this is how Davros is going to be going forward, mm-hmm. apparently. And
oh, okay.
that's kind of interesting, because we all know that Davros got screwed up in the bombing. So it's kind of interesting. I don't know where he's going with this. My knee-jerk reaction was the ending of Planet of the Apes. He blew it up. He blew it up. It's over. But like, the more I sit on it,
mm-hmm.
the more it's like there was this character. The best way that I can tie it in of how I feel about it is like Steamboat with from Captain Marvel. There was a character called Steamboat that was a racist character of black people, right?
Right.
But like, when it was created, it wasn't meant to be as a racist thing. It was meant to be done as humor, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Then people of color actually wrote in and said that what you're doing, even though it is done in a humor way, is harmful because you have 1.5 million readers.
Mm-hmm.
You are outselling Superman.
Right.
And so past 45, they stopped putting out Steamboat without any saying. They just stopped it. And then that was it. So you could just say that Captain Marvel changed for the better of the world. Now, you can literally attribute that to Davros right now. You have a stereotype that, even though most of us have not seen or taken into account, does exist in fiction. There is the disabled guy that is evil stereotype, no matter how it is and whatnot. And you've had Stephen Hawking be called Davros, right? So like, you can't say that like people have not been called Davros, because one of the most well-known, most respected people that are in a wheelchair have been attributed and connected to Davros. So you can say that we are just moving forward with the world, like how RFID said, and we're just putting this to bed. And after that, I'm like, okay, that's fine. But it's just odd because it's such an iconic character.
Yeah, and I know that there's been a lot of debate on the internet. There's been a lot of nastiness on social media about this and back and forth. And
well, it's because people don't know how to debate.
Yeah.
Politely.
No.
But it is that, and also I feel like, because like, this is my thing with
right.
Here, right? I feel like RTD needs to come out and say that he was wrong for creating John Lumick, because he went on and said that there's been the stereotype and whatnot, but he failed to say that himself has attributed himself to it. So since him himself has created John Lumick, he could literally just say, since I've created this character and I've myself attributed to it, I have learned and built from this, I'm going to put an end to this stereotype in the best way I can, to like cut it off with like the pretty much head figure of this kind of, and we're going to move forward.
Well, I mean, he is saying, let's all move forward, but you're right. He didn't actually say, I've done it. It's interesting, though, the trope of that he's talking about, people in wheelchairs being evil, the trope. Right. He actually, and we're not going to get into it deeply right now, but in The Star Beast, there is a character named Shirley Ann Bingham who's in a wheelchair, definitely a goodie. So
yes.
So Russell is practicing what he preached. But yes, he did not apologize for that. And to be honest, I don't think he needs to, because he did do a let's all move on. He did include himself in that statement. So I feel it was enough of it. And, you know, until you mentioned Lumick, John Lumick, I didn't even remember that.
Yeah, just put a cap on it. There's a giant chance that we don't even see Davros ever again in the RTD run.
RTD has said it's time to put the Daleks away.
You see,
that is so weird, though.
Just by association, you may not ever see. Even if the Daleks do come back, it may just be a standalone Dalek episode. We just may just never see Davros as long as RTD is here. So it still is a win-win, because at the end of the day, it's just a show, but it's only helping people that's been attributed to this stereotype.
And, you know, I was a little upset at the second I saw, oh, he's not, but I get past it. It's fiction. Yeah. It's a story. Yeah. Yes, Doctor Who's my show, but you know, it's everyone else's show too, and it's the world's show. It's not just mine. And I did realize and come to grips with the fact that, yeah, he stands. Oh, well. So that was on November 17th. Mm-hmm. On November 23rd, proper 60th anniversary of Doctor Who, BBC Four aired The Daleks, the original Daleks story, a seven-parter, which was 175 minutes long in seven parts, and they made it into an omnibus 75 minutes. But here are the key points. A, they colorized it, looked really nice. B, new music, it made the story flow better. C, better cutting and better pacing. The show seemed like it could have been made and come out now. It's definitely for the new generation of Doctor Who fans who aren't going to sit down and, because there's padding in the original story. I mean, it's 175 minutes. If you can narrow it down to 75 minutes, there's 100 minutes that wasn't needed. Four episodes that wasn't needed. So, and now Zion, we were watching this at my weekend TARDIS 60th anniversary meeting yesterday. What did you feel about the pacing? Because you kind of brought something up.
The pacing, I feel like they could have made it a little bit longer. Mm-hmm. Because I feel like the reason why we feel the pacing is okay is because we've watched the Daleks or like the dead planet, blah, blah, mm-hmm. a billion times.
Yeah.
Like we see the story as scripture. And so like going into it blind, I can only imagine like you are here, you are in the dead forest, 2 seconds in, you are now in a city. Two more seconds in, now everyone is getting hit by radiation sickness. And then two more seconds in, then the Thals show up. And I'm like, oh, whoa, everything's moving fast. And I would like an opinion of someone who's never seen the Daleks and then watch this. Because, like, it's funny. We did a Gundam show, right? You guys remember that when Vicky's son was here?
Yeah.
Mark didn't like the Gundam trilogy. And those three movies are essentially what the Dalek is. What the Dalek colorization is. It's a shrunken down version of the 40 plus episodes of the original series, broken up into three movies, and then put out into Japan. Now, given that was most of Japan's introduction to Gundam, and then it just took off and came to Star Wars. But like essentially, like you lose a lot of nuances and a lot of storytelling if you don't watch like the original series. But like it's still the same thing. If you still break it down to the Daleks.
Yeah.
Like you have like a whole bunch of nuances about the Daleks and them talking to each other. Like that's one thing I noticed about this. They've almost cut out all the scenes where the Daleks are talking to each other.
They added dialogue for the Daleks because they did add lines. They did add things to make the cutting work.
Overall, it still worked. My big problem with it is the voices and the music. The music is too loud at points where you can't even hear the dialogue. Like, thank goodness that we have subtitles because if we didn't, you could not hear them. It was only straight music. And the music, they try to incorporate the old soundtrack into this, but like again, they try to make it modern for the modern day viewer. It just looks weird because like you're watching a 60s show. You know you're watching a 60s episode. So like you have modern music in a 60s show, it took a feel off. At least that's just to me.
I understand that.
And my Star Trek self. Like you imagine Kirk and Spock fighting, but instead of the dun 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 dun
dun dun. Yeah.
Instead you've got Taylor Swift playing in the background.
Oh no. Oh no.
I'm sorry, that was mean.
It just feels off. Like for certain
because it feels different.
That are supposed to be tense, it's just taken away. Like most of the soundtrack for the Daleks is this deathly dark soundtrack. Yeah. It's just like oppressive, like the Daleks.
Think about it though. If they're cutting scenes and cutting bits, they couldn't use the original music anyway because there would have been jump cuts. They had to redo the sound. Even if they used the old music and redid it with the new music, they'd have to figure out how to do that. It was probably easier to make a new soundtrack than to figure out how to re-edit the old one.
You know something? You are 100% correct.
Yeah.
Because I figured that out myself last night.
Yeah.
I went home and said, I'm going to fix this. I can't deal with this music. I can't do it. So I took the original and took the colorized, got rid of the original audio, put it there. And then I sat there for like 2 hours just trying to fix 10 seconds. And I'm like, oh my goodness, these guys edited so much of this thing.
Yeah.
It's almost impossible. But yeah, overall, I still give it like a 7, 8 out of 10 because you get to see colored Hartnell. See colored Hartnell in movement for a whole story is
I have
worth
a question.
The admission.
I have a question. Was Barbara's blouse supposed to be pink? Because
I don't
I'm pretty
know.
Sure it wasn't in the original. I mean,
exactly.
It's an interesting color choice.
It might have been, but I don't know.
Because I know people, I think on the net were saying it's supposed to be blue or something. But
yes.
Again,
oh,
yes.
Interesting.
It is an interesting choice.
Yes, because they never changed clothes from when they took off, right?
Thank you. Yes, you got
yes.
it.
Yes, they never changed clothes. Yes, it is supposed to be blue.
Yeah. Just let you guys know, because you know we're talking about the new one and how you know the old one is kind of you know is different, and you should see it. On the Blu-ray that's going to come out, I know in the United States, the Blu-ray, when it does come out, will have both the colorized and it's in England too, when it comes out. The color copy will be there, and the original 7 episodes will be on the disc too. So you can watch both versions and tell for yourself which way you like it better.
Nice.
And you get the... Now, of course, if you're in England, and we didn't bring this up, you've got the Hooniverse, the entire Hooniverse to watch on the BBC iPlayer. Not complete. Unearthly Child isn't there. There are many reasons for that. Let's just say Anthony Coburn's son and leave it there. I'm not going to go any further than that because I don't want to cause a controversy. I mean, I should. That would get more people to listen to the show. Oh, yeah. Mark, we do this. We say that.
We don't need to do that.
We don't need that. We're above that. When they hit low, we... Oh, no, I can't do that. That's politics. Never mind.
Is there any chance that we'll ever get the full Hooniverse?
Well, okay.
I don't know.
Here's the weird... Okay, so Disney Plus has the show from here on. BritBox, mm-hmm. Tubi, Roku Channel, and other stuff have Classic Who. Max has 2005 Doctor Who until now, Sarah Jane, and Torchwood.
Okay.
When the other...
Thank God I have all of them.
Yeah, but when the deals go off, when their contracts end, it would be nice if Disney picked it up. And it could. We don't know. It could pick them up. Another thing... Unearthly Child, the episode that's not in the Hooniverse, according on the BBC iPlayer, and it's not allowed to stream, still streams on BritBox and all the others, because the contracts for those streaming rights were done before. This is only for the new streaming rights that Unearthly Child right now can't be played. So if you want to see Unearthly Child, in the United States at least, go ahead and watch it. It's there. And in England, you've got it on, I think, BritBox or possibly another service out there. So it's not gone. And hopefully this will all be worked out. And I know it's not streaming, but people are worried when the season 1 Blu-ray collection comes out, will it be on there? We don't know. But this is mostly about streaming rights, the controversy, not...
Right.
So, yeah.
Can I tell one last thing about the Daleks thing?
Go for it.
The ending. Oh, my goodness. That colorized montage
of
all those things... I wanted to tear my hair out because I swear I saw Dalek Master Plan.
Yeah.
I was like, give it to me now. Just hand it to me.
Well, you know, there's RTD, I think, has said, you know, he'd like to colorize all the black and white episodes. And that kind of shows that, yeah, they may do it because they have little clips of a lot of different episodes in color now. So maybe that's the push he needs to do it. primarily when something is colorized, I'm not a big fan of the colorized version.
I'm not
either. Ted Turner really irked me back when he started doing that.
Mm-hmm. I refuse to watch any of the movies colorized.
What's his name? The guy that made Citizen Kane, I think.
Orson Welles.
Yeah, he said himself, I am not going to let Ted Turner deface my movie with his crayons.
Exactly. Yep. Exactly.
That's hilarious.
But these Doctor Who ones, because it's not strictly the same movie colorized, and there are added things and cut things and new music, it's like a new episode. It's like a different story, even if it's the same story. It's a different episode. So I probably will watch them, and I did like the Daleks in color. A QM product. No, okay. okay. And also want to bring this up before we go to our commercial break. On the 23rd, right after the Daleks, they reshowed An Adventure in Space and Time, the 50th anniversary docudrama about the origins of Doctor Who, as written by Mark Gatiss. There was some edited out because some of the things in there were about An Unearthly Child, and they had to go because they don't have rights to it streaming. But I don't know why, really. They did something that was pretty amazing. Do you guys know what it is? I know Zion does.
No.
Do you know what it is?
Yeah.
Okay. There is the scene at the end. The character of William Hartnell is ready, just about to pass over the role to Patrick Troughton, and he's standing in his doctor outfit by the TARDIS, looking thoughtful. And he looks over, and there's Matt Smith's doctor looking at him. They're smiling at each other. It's a tender moment. In this episode that just came out, the re-showing, they took Matt Smith out and put Shooty in.
Oh, wow.
Same facial expressions, except for a wink. Shooty gave a wink, but it was the same. Oh, wow. That was good. So
I love it when they throw in that little continuity sort of thing.
Mark Gatiss has actually said he'll, do it for every doctor. Whenever it is a new doctor, throw someone else in.
Why not?
That's what I was about to ask. They didn't film that for Peter or Jodie, right?
Right. No, they didn't. But they hadn't shown, they weren't showing the episode again, so they could have. But, and also because RTD's back in charge, maybe he thought it was right, and Chibnall didn't think of it. I don't know. It could be anything.
Makes sense.
Yeah. Okay, folks, we're going to take a little break here to pay our bills here on the podcast. When we come back, we're going to talk all about the first special, the 60th anniversary season, The Star Beast. We'll be right back.
Don't go away. Don't go away. We'll be back with more Mark Who 42 after this.
Get ready for the ultimate geek experience right here in the Sunshine State. Florida Geek Scene presents a full calendar of events and conventions. From anime to horror, we've got it all. Meet your favorite stars, find rare collectibles, and immerse yourself in your passions. Experience the thrill of cosplay and witness amazing live performances. Stay up to date with the latest news and reviews all across Florida. Florida Geek Scene, where pop culture happens. Visit us online for more. Don't miss out on the fun. Join us at Florida Geek Scene, floridageekscene.com.
The Pullbag is GCRN's comic book review and discussion-based podcast. Join me, TFG and Mike, and the rest of the GCRN crew as we discuss the comics we are reading right now. Inside The Pullbag, you'll also find the origins of how guests got into or out of reading comics, After Dark discussions, and so much more. You can find The Pullbag every Wednesday, which is New Comic Book Day, only on GeekCastRadio.com and on anywhere you consume your podcasts. Make your greatest game into comics and jump into The Pullbag today.
You are listening to Mark Who 42's Universe.
Welcome back to Mark Who 42's Universe, here everywhere around the net on podcast platforms, every kind you can think of. I'm your host, Mark Baumgarten, and we've got Vicky Jakubowski and Zion Quiros, my co-hosts, on. And we're now here to talk about the 60th anniversary specials of Doctor Who. They just showed the day before us recording this on Saturday the 25th. They showed The Star Beast, The Star Beast was written by Russell T. Davis, based on a story by Pat Mills and Dave Gibbons from the Doctor Who Weekly issues 19 through 26. Yes, Russell has, you remember like Human Nature they did in Dalek, which was from Jubilee, they did from either written prose or an audio prose?
Yep.
We've done the comic books now. Thank you, Russell. I love the strip this is based on. And we're going to talk about the strip it's based on after we talk about the episode. But I just want to say the writer and artist of the strip, Pat Mills and Dave Gibbons, and you've heard their names before in many things, Judge Dredd, Watchmen, Green Lantern. They've separately done a lot of things. But they have said, because they were on the set while they were filming it, they gave their thumbs up to this rendition of it. So to have the creators love what they're doing to their script, to their comic, is really good. So this story, I loved it. I don't know about you guys. Did you guys love the episode?
Yes.
Yeah, how about
I
you?
I thought it was really good. I thought I give it like an 8.
Oh, wait, you're giving it, because you gave the Daleks a 7 or 8. You're giving this an 8?
Yes.
Okay.
Because at the end of the day, the Daleks are still the Daleks. Come on. I mean, like, come on. That's Terry Nation's baby.
All right, that's true. The director of this story was Rachel Talele, who has directed the season ender two-parters of all the Peter Capaldis and a few other things. So we got her back. I know she had a bout with cancer, but she is doing better. She's in remission. She's doing better. Thank you. And Rachel was actually at Chicago TARDIS over the weekend. And before they showed the Star Beast at the convention, they had her do a little intro and end. You know, she did a little talk with her about the episode. I want to get her on the show. That would be really cool.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Love it.
Yeah. In this
story, I have to disagree with Zion just a little bit, because I would give this a 9.8.
I agree. I would too. I would too.
It was damn near perfect. Mm-hmm. I laughed. I cried. I hooted. I hollered. And I like the writing. I like the acting. I like the actors. And, Donna is up there. Mm-hmm. And she is definitely always been one of my top five companions. Mm-hmm. I think it's now official. She is in my top three. Sometimes they interchange a little bit. I love it because she's quirky like I am. So
I think this episode was good for the Whovians and the Whoobies who have just joined the shows. Have you ever heard the word Whoobies before?
No. I thought we were all Whovians.
Well, no, but no, Whovians are Whovians. Doctor Who newbies. Exactly. Oh. That was coined on yesterday's Doctor Who Unleashed, which is a show they're doing kind of like Doctor Who Confidential, but they just changed the name. It's basically the same show. And the host of it made a joke about Whovians. So so that's what we're called now. Whovians, and you new people are Whovians. Thank you, folks.
Is that going to be like the Trekkers versus the Trekkies? Debate.
It could be. Yeah. Well, I mean, what about the Whoies and the Whoites and the Hooligans?
Oh, I never heard those before.
I don't either. I'm just making them up, but they work for me too. The Hooligans. For the
Hooligans.
The
Hooligans.
Okay. Yeah. That's a whole nother meaning, kids.
I thought that this episode was actually good from a story wise, but I think it was phenomenal as an introduction wise.
I
feel like this story was the maximized story to say, okay, new era, we're on Disney Plus, we're going forward. It's from the jump, even with that introduction with the Doctor and Donna, like that's clearly there because we have the new Disney Plus people coming in, and I saw that coming, and that's obvious just seeing it. But the way that they supported it with the episode, and the episode still filling in the way it was, I say double thumbs up on that end.
Well, yeah, the fact that Disney Plus didn't put a placard on their website or their app until the 22nd, And then and they had the word, there was a place to click for watch list, add it to your watch list. There was no trailer. And then at 1:31 on the 25th, which would have been 6:31 in England, so a minute after it started on the BBC, if you refresh Disney Plus, there is the trailer and the movie, the episode to watch. You can watch it then. I found it interesting that they did that. They also, I get an email from Disney Plus every couple of days telling you what to watch and what's coming up. Didn't get one for this. It's like they weren't advertising. And that kind of pissed me off. But I also realized that a lot of times Disney Plus does it on the email after they start showing something. Like, I think they were talking about Loki, but they didn't do a major Loki email until the day after. So maybe I could check my email now and there's something about Doctor Who. I don't know. But I do think it was kind of poor Disney putting a lot of money into this and then not going crazy with advertising.
Yeah. The market's here. 2011.
Around the world, the market is. This is new for everyone.
Well, I kind of wonder if Disney was not putting the money into it because the BBC was. It was all over YouTube. It was all over the internet. It was all over Instagram. It was all over X. It was all over Threads. It was all over everything.
Why
it was
waste
all over
more
TikTok.
Money? Yeah.
But
so
wait,
why did they need to have to spend any money when everyone else was doing it for them?
Okay.
Because
At least put it on your website. At least put it on the app that it's coming. Well, let's watch the trailer. Put it there. Don't just say, have a little description, watch list plus. And
but
two days before they actually show it.
But everything that we can that we just said can be attributed to how our algorithm is custom tailored to our likes. Mm-hmm. Like, there could be someone that never watched Doctor Who and still never got a trailer. Like, my brother watched it back in like 2016 and then stops. And I've asked him, have you seen any trailers? And he said, nope.
Wow.
And we live in the same house.
All right. So, you know, Disney Plus, you put it on, you're helping pay for it. I give cheers for that. I just wish it had gone a little more on getting the people who don't know who to come forward and try it. Yes, it was on the internet.
Yeah, there
but
wasn't
not
a
everyone.
Lot of, oh, look at, you know, let's get new viewers on. It was more of, if you were already a fan, you were set.
Now, that is actually a good point, because if you think about it, you've heard Russell say that Shooty, when he starts, it's going to be season one all over again.
Yes.
And I think that's because, since they don't have the back catalog on Disney Plus, yeah, you don't want to advertise, hey, go to BritBox, hey, go to Max, and, you know, give their competitors. So they are treating it like a new show. And if they do, that means they're going to put a lot of money into season one. And this is just something they're showing because it's a celebratory thing. They're not pushing this because the show, in Disney's eyes, starts March, April next year.
No, that could be true, because this is a bridge in one respect.
But again, it's David Tennant. The money bag is right there.
I know.
You'd think, because he is a very, very in-demand actor. You know,
yes.
Good Omens 2, Staged.
Yes.
Yeah.
Those were fabulous. And, you know, it's just not the sort of thing. I know you do. You start to really wonder, you know, are you guys thinking about this all? And I don't know. You always kind of wonder what goes on in their heads, because we always think, well, why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? And it's sometimes hard to figure out what goes on in the head of a corporate boardroom. You know, when do we spend the money? When do we not? And I get it. It's difficult. It's always hard to figure out how to spend the money and how to not. And we do know that Disney Plus, all streaming services to a certain extent are hemorrhaging money. They don't charge enough for what they're paying out to a certain extent. To a certain extent, not every piece of content makes the money that, say, something like a Doctor Who or a Loki brings in. Not everything's an A-plus product.
Right.
So it kind of becomes, I don't know, it's an interesting thought process. And because right now, all I'm seeing is the new Tim Allen Santa Claus TV show.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, you know, no offense, that's going to bring in some audience. I haven't watched it yet. Mm-hmm. And I love Christmas movies, but I'm like, but I wanted to see the Doctor Who. I'm like, you know, and I was just like, and I was really surprised. It wasn't even when I put, every time I went on to Disney Plus, I was like, why is it not front and center? Ooh, right, mm-hmm. boom, mm-hmm. Ah, you know?
Yeah.
I really expected more of that.
You know, I was thinking on the app, on the Disney Plus, you know, they have a place you could pick all the Marvels, all the Star Wars, all the, you know, like the little things at the top. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What are they going to do for Doctor Who? Where are they going to put Doctor Who? I mean, if they do a Whoniverse, if the more different stories come out, I'm sure eventually they'll put a Doctor Who thing at the top. But it's kind of isn't it kind of going to get lost in the streaming service?
That's what I wonder.
Without having a direct go-to on the front page?
I wonder.
You would probably have to search for it.
Yeah.
This again is a problem.
Yeah, definitely. You know, guys, I think we've taken a tangent. Now, all the stuff all the stuff we've talked about is stuff I wanted to talk about, but we've taken a tangent. Let's talk about the Star Beast. I'm just saying. We definitely want to talk.
Let's go
it was important.
Go back to what we were talking about.
What we're talking about. So, David Tennant, as last we saw, not including Destination Scarrow, he's just been regenerated from Jody, and he's drawn back to Donna Noble's life, and he meets her daughter Rose. Now, when the Doctor runs into Donna, and she's not allowed to know who he is, and then he hears Rose, he's like, "Wait a minute, Rose is here too? What?"
Was so cute. Yeah. It's like, Rose, where's Rose? Where's Rose?
But Rose is actually, like I said, Donna's daughter.
Yes.
And while this is happening, a spaceship is coming in and crash landing. Or
and
is
once
it?
Again, Donna misses the wrong
it.
Way.
Donna misses it, never sees it. And basically, the Meep, which is this real cuddly little Disney character. No, it's from Pat Mills' story.
I love it.
Meep is the cute little adorable fuzzball, and there are these aliens chasing it called the Rorth Warriors. And Rose finds Meep, hides Meep in the shed that Wilf used to use when he was looking for aliens. And there is a fight between Unit and the Rorth Warriors in Donna's house. They get out. So the Doctor, not really getting the whole situation, puts on his courtroom hairpiece and declares the Shadow Proclamation courtroom is open. And during the court thing, you know, he realizes, well, the Rorth Warriors aren't shooting with real lasers. They're shooting with stun guns, and nothing has been destroyed. People are getting hit or actually asleep and not dead. And he realizes that Meep is the evil one, and Meep decides, well, yeah, I'm the evil one, and goes ballistic. And regardless of what's happening, the scene in the still works.
So
it was. That was a great scene. Meep is going to take off in his ship. Oh, sorry. Meep is going to take off in Meep's ship. Let's get the pronouns right. Meep is going to take off in Meep's ship, which has been repaired by Unit soldiers who are under some kind of influence from the Meep, and is going to take off. But the type of rocket it is going to destroy London when it takes off, and that's not a good thing, is it? Is that a good thing, destroying London? I mean, Doctor Who is mostly filmed at Cardiff, so it wouldn't stop Doctor Who from being made. But yeah, I think it would cause a problem. I think there'd be a problem. I think there'd be a problem. So the Doctor has to try saving the day. Donna comes in. Now remember, Donna is not supposed to know who he is. They're not telling her who he is. What did you think the first time she said the Doctor? Did you miss that? Because I think only the second time.
Did she say it?
Because the second time she said it, that's when the Doctor realized, wait a minute, she said it. How does she know I'm the Doctor? So they save the day. But I'm not going to go into the whole plot because I want you to watch it. But the interesting thing is that to save the day, the Doctor has to remind Donna who he is, so that she can turn back to the Doctor Donna and help stop the ship from taking off. And he does it. And, well, you think she dies, but she doesn't. And there's a reason for that. Does anyone want to take over and give the reason why she didn't die?
Well, I think I'm best suited for that.
Go for it.
Because I'm a mother.
Yes, you are.
And as a mother, You know, we share a part of our soul and our life force with our children. And that's exactly what she did. And she shared it with Rose, and she shared both the burden and the joy of the Time Lord energy with Rose. And so it wasn't the burden on just one, it was shared. That's why she didn't explode.
And because if you think about it, because the power was shared, she didn't have as much power. She was still going to die, but there was more time, more time. But it's actually interesting because at the very end, when the doctor, they're like, "How are we going to cure you?" Donna and Rose were like, "Well, you know, we're women. We can just go and let it go." And I'm sorry, when they said "let it go," I'm thinking, "Oh, Disney, really? Do we have to go Disney?" But energy went away, and wow, and they're cured. Donna's cured. When all this is wrapped up, the doctor invites Donna for a one more ride. Donna's mother, "No, you are not going." And Rose is like, "Can I go?" No. Donna goes with the doctor. They step through the door. The second that door opened, I'm going to myself, I can see where the Disney money went.
Absolutely.
The TARDIS, immense, bright, just completely unlike any version that's been seen before. And Donna is trying to tell the doctor, "Oh, you have a new chance of life. Why don't you start coming to tea, coming to lunch, coming to functions with the family, you know, change." And he's like, "Well, yeah, maybe." The TARDIS, though, has a coffee maker now. The doctor gets Donna a cup of coffee the way she likes it. And she made a joke. Well, not really a joke. "It's how I lost my job. Dropped my coffee in a computer."
Yes.
And then she goes a few minutes later, "This is where everyone should have been paying attention and knew it was going to happen. What could go wrong?" Spilled the coffee. "Oh my God, I did
We
it
all knew
again."
that was going to
It
happen.
did. It was so predictable. And here's the funny thing.
It had to happen.
It
Did
had
she
to
do it on
happen.
purpose?
I don't know. No, it's kind of like I you can't see what I'm doing because I'm doing it in front of people them, and you can't see it on the radio. But it's an actual muscle twitch. So I don't think it was on purpose. But you know, the thing about predictability, and I hate to say this, my sister who lives in England thought the whole episode was predictable, and she actually didn't like this. Yeah,
That's fair.
I know it is fair, but you
But
know,
you know, some of it, I mean, Donna is predictable because Donna's Donna.
exactly.
You know, there are some things that, and you can say that sometimes about the doctor. The doctor has, and of course, sometimes his traits adjust in his various versions. But, you know, there are some things that the doctor has done when he's had the face of David Tennant versus Matt Smith, but there are certain things that you know the doctor's going to do certain things because it's the doctor. You know there's things that Martha was going to do because it was Martha, and you know there were choices that Rose was going to make when Rose was young Rose, and then when Rose was bad wolf Rose. There are things that Donna's going to do because Donna's Donna. I'm going to tell you right now, as the person who can trip on air and can cause death and destruction everywhere she goes, long before I ever was in a wheelchair, and I still seem to be able to do it. And there are things that I do because it's me. And while it may be predictable, it's still going to happen because it's still me. If it didn't happen, then it wouldn't be me. So I get it, and I understand, but there's a difference between being a, well, they just did that because they had to do that because if it didn't happen, then well, blah, blah, blah. And then there's a, well, of course, because this person or this character, this is what they do. You know, it would not be true to them. You know, it would be like if Donna suddenly became, you know, an axe-wheeling maniac.
There'd be a
That would
plot
not
reason
be
for
true to
it. No,
Donna.
no.
So that's why Donna always knew and always had these dreams, because Donna was still Donna,
Right.
no matter how much they tried to erase her memories.
Now, what did you guys think? Because at the end of part two of End of Time, the doctor gave Donna as a wedding present, or you know, a lottery ticket, and you find out that 15 years before the episode we just watched was she won. It was a winning lottery ticket, 166 million pounds. It was a triple rollover, and what did she do?
She gave it away.
Donna of old, before she met the doctor, would that ever have happened?
Yeah, I don't know if I even like the explanation that they gave, because like the whole thing that they're trying to say is that, oh, she gave it away because she was trying to be like be a doctor, right?
She had the thought patterns of when she, yes.
But the entire time, the doctor just like, why would you give it away?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be like the number one like thing Donna. That Jack would think?
Like him.
Yeah.
See, well, the doctor would need the money. And the doctor would always try and do the most good. And in general, not every time. Sometimes he just saved one life. But in general, the doctor was trying to maximize.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, God, he was always trying to save the Earth and then the universe. And he was always trying to just do the most good. Sometimes, but completely by accident.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that Donna had more good to her. And even though, yes, did she have a selfish trait? Oh my God, yes. I think that she was far more generous than people gave her credit for. Because you look at some of the stuff she did in the beginning, some of the choices she made. She actually had some generosity.
But you still take care of your family. Like, you...
Well,
like,
she bought a house. She bought a house for herself. And Rose wasn't alive then. Wasn't born yet. So it was just her...
But you could still set yourself off and still give away, like, 75% to charity.
How much is a house? I mean, maybe that she thought because they were
both...
They
had, like, 150 million pounds, right?
Maybe she thought with them both working, they would be able to live comfortably in the house that they now have. I see it kind of. I'm like the doctor.
Not to mention
you gave it away. What? What?
Change people. Come
yeah.
On.
Yeah. So maybe
the lottery has a lot of negativity to it.
Another reason. Remember, she had the forgetting. They thought she had. You know, she thought she had a breakdown. Maybe she, you know, she was changing her life and she just couldn't deal with the money.
I know. I get it. I just only look at it from a certain point of view that the doctor would do certain things before he would give it away. If he had a family.
Well, Donna doesn't think sometimes. Sometimes she puts her foot in her mouth and she gave it away.
Yes.
I mean, she even said when she got her memory back, why did I give that money away?
Yes.
I'm stupid.
That scene was perfect.
Yeah.
Because, like, you know how to give her props. Like, it was literally a switch. As soon as this flip was switched, I was like, oh, and there she is. She's been there the entire time. And yeah, I just really love that scene. It's like she just boom back, and like I could feel all the Donna fans that and all the 10 Donna fans that have been just been waiting for this to come back, just saying, yes, here it is, the banter.
Well, part of it is. It was funny when they first announced all those years ago that Catherine Tate was going to come on and be the bride. I thought she was hilarious. And I was like, oh, she'll be an interesting one-off.
Mm-hmm.
And then she was fabulous. And then I was like, God, I hope she comes back. And when we did get her back, I was so happy for her. I actually was one of those people that I enjoyed Martha. I liked Martha a lot, and I felt like they did not utilize Martha enough.
They did not.
I felt like they really squandered that. But that said, Catherine Tate as a companion, I was won over so quickly because she was just so amazing and goofy and hilarious. Mm-hmm. And just, I'm a little schizoid myself, which is, you know, my three sides of my personality are River Song and Sarah Jane and Donna.
There you go.
And there's a reason those three companions to me. And I love the way that she makes him such a better doctor.
Yeah.
And I love the way he immediately changes her. And because the next time we saw her in an episode, she's trying to be the doctor. I mean,
yeah.
You think about that.
And that's why she gave the money away. She was trying to be
and
the doctor.
Why,
she was still
she
that.
She was already trying to be like the doctor.
Yeah.
in her next episode. He affected her the way he affected Sarah Jane.
Yeah.
But Sarah Jane became a very serious investigative reporter, whereas Donna became, mm-hmm. I don't know what the hell Donna thought she was, but,
right.
you know, she was trying to solve the world's problems mm-hmm. herself. And I love it. And I love this character. And it was so perfect. And of course, she would have sacrificed herself the way that she would have. Mm-hmm. And we could never have left her the way that she could never have just stayed away
mm-hmm.
in the way she did. And she couldn't have. There had to be a finality to her ending. It yeah. couldn't end with her having her memory wiped. There had to be more to her story.
I'm just scared what's going to happen to her in two more episodes.
She's going to kick fucking Tate's names. That's what she's going to do.
It's chew bubblegum and
yes.
You know, all through the years, you know, Sarah Jane was the doctor's best friend. Yeah. Joe was the doctor's best friend. Donna is truly I think the doctor's, I hate to say this, the doctor's favorite happens to be Donna. The fact that
there's an interesting connection between
the connection. Yeah, it's different than the friendship that the previous doctors yes. had with their companions. Donna and the doctor, and even, you know, the doctor and Rose. That was
right.
It's very different. But the doctor and Donna, true friends to the end. And I know the doctor was heartbroken when yes. he had to wipe her memory. And then when he's basically killing her in this episode to giving yes. her memory back, he is like, this isn't fair. And he's just dying. You can yes. see he is dying.
And I think that's so very important because, you know, we saw with Rose where there right. was this clear love connection. We see with Martha where we have the unrequited love from mm-hmm. Martha. And with Donna, there's no romantic love on either
they're
side.
Mates.
They are mates.
Yeah.
They would go down to the corner and have a pint together. And and they would probably sit there and argue. they would argue about the football match. I could
there
picture them doing it.
They would.
You know, and neither one of them was going to give the other one an inch. And that's what they would have been. And they would have been you know, in another life, they would have been the best of mates for their entire lives because that's the type of people they were. Mm-hmm. Didn't matter that they were male and female, that they were Earthling and Time Lord. They were mates and they were just all. And, you know, when you think about it and you think about all the companions that he had, I mean, did he really have any true mates?
No,
it was kind of like what the Master could have been if mm-hmm. they had, if they ended up not being rivals.
What Missy would mm-hmm. have been had her previous mm-hmm. self not killed her.
Yeah.
Yeah. I see that.
It just, you look at it and you go, yeah, the Doctor's never been lucky enough mm-hmm. to have that. And you kind of go, well, and when you have those kind of mates, you know, I have yeah. a handful of friends like that, that, you know, they're your ride or dies. You would go down in a flaming ball of ash with them. You know, you would die on a rocket ship trying to save the universe with them. Mm-hmm. And it just, it's a special kind of friendship. And I love the fact that it's Donna.
How do you guys feel about Rose? I enjoyed her character for the most of it until RTD decided to hit the heavy hand on me at the last second. But that's it. Outside of that one part where it says binary, non-binary.
Hold on.
I feel like that's a little bit heavy-handed. But that's it. Everything else, I have to give him props.
That I gotta say something. Great. Zion. When she was the Dr. Donna in the last series 4 that she was in, there's a scene where she goes, binary. There's a scene in that. Yeah, and when she's Dr. Donna, And do you think RTD had, wow, I'm going to set this up for later? Because he basically did.
I don't think he was planning on it, particularly because of how he handled the meta crisis thing exactly right after that. Because, like, he kind of just said, he just wiped it away, said, okay, she just let it go. In terms of Rose, I want to say, like, every scene that, like, they, like, tried to, like, touch up on her trans life and such, I want to say, you guys did great.
Yeah, it's interesting because I know they're kind of like the problem with Davros standing up. There's been a lot of controversy with some people about the fact of Rose. And I don't, I mean, I, you know, there are people in this world who are against this, and it's going to, they're not going to watch Doctor Who anymore because of it. Well, you know what? They're lost. Because the fact that this character is integral to the plot, it's not like the character just happens to be trans and the fact that she's trans, the doctor even realized to save the day, man and woman and neither and more.
Yes.
The binary, non-binary, binary, non-binary. It is so integral to the plot, you could not do it. Now, yeah, you could have wrote a different plot, but that's not the story that Russell was telling. It totally fit. It had to be, and it was.
You know what's my favorite scene in the entire episode? When Donna is talking to her mom in the kitchen.
Oh, yeah.
I honestly felt like that was him giving us a small look into the households.
Yeah.
Because I, like, sitting there looking at it, I was like, I could actually see that happening, even though I've never thought of it happening. But I was like, that actually probably most likely does happen. It's interesting to see that he put it here in a family that he didn't even put as someone that would have a trans kid in the previous series. So, like, it's kind of interesting to see that, like, the previous gen is navigating toward through this new world. I'm like, okay. I like it. And also, I want to talk about this because we were talking about him.
I was totally going to go there. Go for it. Go for it.
misgendering Meep, right?
Yeah.
I want to say, like, he was just playing along because he said, oh, yeah, I am just Meep and all such. But then he turned to the actual Meep and called Rose weird. And like the way that the scene was set up,
it was later on, insinuated that
he was poking at the bear in the room.
The Meep was evil.
Yes.
Hold on. Meep the Beep. They're just calling it the Meep. It's Meep the Beep. And that's from the comic. I'm sorry. That they changed. I didn't like. I didn't like just calling it the Meep. Calling the Meep the Meep. I like Meep the Beep. But yeah, I see what you're saying. I got to say something. And this is something we talked about also, Zion. The fact that, wow, the sonic screwdriver really can do some really cool things now.
Oh my God.
That was awesome.
It can make sonic shields. And
It's too OP. That's not what I want, that one.
Disney, again, that's the.
That's the budget talking.
Like, I'll take it.
I'll take it too. Disney, you're doing a good job so far, except for advertising. Just saying.
So now we could actually have like David Tennant on Disney Channel and say, hey, I am David Tennant and you're watching Disney Channel. And actually just draw Disney with his
they don't do that no more.
right after Doctor Who on BBC One, they have Strictly Dancing. Okay, I think they have something like here in America, but it's originated there. And when they're going for the rules of the voting, they say, take it away, David. And then it's David Tennant slipping between David Tennant and the doctor type dialogue and basically giving the instructions. And he says, and if you miss Doctor Who, go to the iPlayer. It's on now. And I just like, see, that's what we need. I showed this yesterday too, Zion. The fact that the BBC News had Daleks come on the set to advertise.
Nice.
That, where is that in America? Where?
Nope, we can't get that for some reason. Not even a TV commercial.
No.
Not even a single TV commercial.
Well, it's all on YouTube. Yeah.
Again, tangents. We got to hold this one. But yeah, the sonic screwdriver. Look, this is just me. My favorite time of the Doctor is when he doesn't have it, where he actually has to think and get himself out of things, kind of.
Yeah.
So, like, there was that episode from The Visitation where that alien...
The pterileptils.
Yes. and he destroyed the screwdriver. I need him next episode.
Well,
this
hold
thing
on.
Needs to, it's too strong. It's too strong for me.
I saw someone post on Facebook today after seeing the episode, we need to bring this creature back. And then it was a picture of the pterileptals because of the sonic screwdriver. Because of the sonic screwdriver. Was that you? That wasn't you, was it?
That was me.
That was you. Oh, my God. Oh, but then, no, I don't pay attention. I just look at the pretty pictures and say, oh, I like that. I don't look at your name. Why would I look at your name? I just look at the pictures. It's easier.
Nice.
But no, that's great set.
Oh, my goodness. Because, like, oh, my. Like, because, like, I'm trying to think about this in a canon sort of way. Like, I watch Doctor Who like I'm a cosmic fly on his wall at all times, so I know everything.
Yeah.
So now, since I'm here and I'm in their house watching this, I gotta ask myself, why don't you have this before? Because this is a guy who has access to all points in time at all points in space. What century, on what planet did you get this from, this new attachment or software to the sonic screwdriver? Why did you do it before? Because I'm look, there's no way in heck that you could tell me that Matt Smith would not put that in there. You can't tell me that the man that would.
It's called Disney. It's called Disney money. That's the only reason it happened. Disney money. That's why it happened.
But it's just so weird. It's just so off-putting. Yeah, it's too strong. It's a sonic screwdriver.
I remember in the Patrick Chodden stories, it was a device that unscrewed screws.
But like I'm on.
That's what a sonic screwdriver is. With sound, it unscrewed a screw. That was it.
It is like a mom. When John Hurt said, what are you going to do? Assemble a cabinet?
Assemble a cabinet at him, yeah.
Now he could actually do it.
It looks that way. Maybe that's why it's been advanced. Okay, we were talking about, I think I brought this up during our talk about Davros, one of the, I thought, the best characters in the show. And I hope she comes back when Unit appears in The Giggle. I'm pretty sure that's where Unit's going to reappear. Ruth Manily as Shirley Ann Bingham of Unit. I love the character in a wheelchair.
I told my husband I want him to build me a wheelchair like that.
You need a wheelchair like that.
I want it with all those booms.
It shoots out darts and then missiles straight. And just wow. Where did you get? Wow, I like that. We all have them or something.
Yeah. I needed to get. First, it was just shooting those little ones. That was great. Mm-hmm. And that's not all. Mm-hmm. And then it had the big missiles. It's like, yes, I want one. Mine's very boring compared to this. Yeah. I need something that goes boom.
And with her, the fact that she didn't even have to get introduced to the doctor. She totally knew who he was. Totally knew his history, back history, because she's the scientific advisor. Scientific advisor, what, 56, I think? 57?
56,
okay.
I think.
I have to bring this up because a friend of mine told me I have to mention it on this review, so I will. The doctor says, I used to be scientific advisor number one. No. Yes. No.
Oh.
Liz Shaw was the scientific advisor for a couple of hours before the doctor was brought in. She's technically, so he is not,
right.
he is science advisor two.
Number two.
There's a little error there. And just saying, thank you.
Kiss.
This is Mark Kiss. Woda. Mark Woda, Kiss. Thank you very much for bringing that to my attention. I'm glad I got to mention it. RTD, maybe he's writing all this good stuff. Made one little error. That's okay.
That's okay. We'll let the excitement of the moment, and we'll just let that slide.
Right. So when Shirley Ann Bingham thinks that the doctor is the 10th doctor and he starts talking about his future selves, she said, you can't do that, that it's not following the laws of time. You're breaking the laws of time. And he goes, yeah, but I'm not that doctor. And let's talk a little about this. The fact that the doctor has come back as the 10th doctor, but it's not. It's the 14th doctor. This is my imagination, or it could be totally guessing the plot and being predictable. I think that now that we know that in The Giggle, Neil Patrick Harris is playing the toy maker, that Shuti is actually the 14th doctor. And this is something that the toy maker has done to the doctor to make him believe that he looks like him in order to, because at the very, and this is important, at the very end of the episode, right when the Meep is captured, the Meep goes,
"So you beware, Doctor, because there is one more thing. A creature with two hearts is such a rare thing. Just wait till I tell my boss."
Uh-huh. And you're going, "Oh, dang."
Yeah, and the Doctor goes, "Cryptic. I hate that." But the fact of the matter is,
yeah,
you know, maybe he's not the 14th. Maybe it, we're being, this is all a rigmarole. A rigmarole? Yeah. This is, yeah, did I use the right word there? I'm making a word up. No, it's a real word. The whole thing is a mishigash. We're right. Putting the wool, Russell is putting the wool over our eyes to tell a damn good story. And I think so far I think so far he is. What are your opinions on the fact that the 10th Doctor seems to be back, but as the 14th?
I think it's actually him, because he actually acts like him. Because then, at that point, then Shuri had must act like Tennant right now. That's the only way.
No. She regenerated, but the toy maker caught the essence between Jodi and Shuri. That Jodi did regenerate. And yes. Shuri is in the middle of regenerating when all this is happening. There is that scene in the trailer that shows Shuri going, "What the hell is going on here?" And there's everything behind him is faded out, so you can't see where he's saying that. And I've heard things say, yeah, that's a misleading picture to screw with everyone. But he may show up in these specials and be trying to get out of where the Toymaker has put him.
I feel like
that's just my thought.
That's possible, and I'm almost certain that like that's what this whole thing is. It's a complete game of the Toymaker.
Definitely.
But I want to bring up like the extent of it, right? Mm-hmm. And like it kind of scares me, because like we have to take into account that we have a character named Rose and David Tennant here.
Right.
Right. So there's a very thin line between, hey, the Toymaker is influencing with the Doctor's life. And A and B, Rose is named Rose because of the Toy Maker, which opens a whole other can of worms.
I think the Toy Maker would make his world, the world he's created, very, very meticulously, and would put all those details in there. So I don't think it's above the Toy Maker's. And also, if you think about it, when that ship, when it didn't take off, and all the damage to London disappeared.
Yeah,
that's something. Something is up. That doesn't make sense unless someone's playing a game.
If that's the case, then I just hope that Rose isn't trans because of the Celestial Toymaker.
Oh, I see. I'm almost
certain that RTD would not do that.
Well, no, I see what you're saying, but I don't think
that's the case. I'm hoping that's not the case.
No, I'm thinking if the Toymaker's doing this, this isn't actually London. This isn't actually, they're not, it's completely different. And, but I see what you're saying. To make the Toymaker responsible for that.
But open a can of worms.
It's tricky. It's a tricky statement.
I think there's something going on. What that something is, I don't know.
Yeah.
And I am interested to see what happens next.
Yeah.
And I am intrigued to see what happens next. But I do think that there's something else afoot.
So about the meta crisis thing and them letting go. Okay, that's fine. So does that mean that Donna doesn't have the hyper intelligence anymore?
Right. Donna and Rose are no longer Time Lord brains. They let it go. They are just normal people now. But Rose can finally be herself because Rose is no longer living under the Time Lord influence. Remember, all those dolls that, you know, that Rose was selling are based on memories of Donna's, of the aliens they met.
He also had, you know, Donna's memories.
Donna's memories. Yeah, it was,
she
all influencing.
She can be whoever she wants to be.
Exactly, exactly.
Also, this TARDIS room is a giant safety hazard.
Oh, I love it.
Like all, like,
oh, when they
like
fall, all, when the ship, when the TARDIS gets rocked, turns, you can just fall over.
Exactly. Oh my goodness. That's what I was thinking about.
Yes.
I was thinking about that one scene where Five and Tegan and like Turlo are hanging on the TARDIS just barely. I'm like, oh, I can only imagine if that happens in a disc console. You're going to be falling for like 30 seconds and then you hit your head on a rail and then that's right. And then you fall back to where you were.
I got better than that. Enemy of the World, Patrick Troughton's story. The door is open when they take off in the TARDIS, and everything gets sucked out, and Salamander, the one that looks exactly like the Doctor, is sucked out. That whole scene,
oh, yeah,
they're holding on. The ship is sideways and being mm-hmm. sucked out. That yeah. would not be good in this TARDIS. Oh, no, you're right.
No.
You're right. One last thing I want to say about the episode is Murray Gold's music. Ooh, I'm so glad he's back. But here's a cool thing. So a lot of the music were renditions of stuff he did for the, 12 years he did the music for, or so. A lot of it were different renditions of it. And I thought it was really cool and weird to see a sequence where David Tennant is either running or doing something action-wise, and they're playing Matt Smith music in the background. I love that.
Uh-huh. I like
that was cool.
What I felt was the mismatch mm-hmm. of some of the different themes from over the years.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yes.
Of the new Who's.
Yeah.
And you would hear it and you would go, wow,
yeah.
I know that. Oh, I know that. Oh. And it just, because it evoked an emotion, and it was very nice
yeah.
to kind of feel that stuff going on underneath, because it added to the whole overall, I don't know. I felt maybe because it was new, because it was back, because it was David, because it was Russell. I don't know, but everything about it was very emotional for me.
Yeah.
In lots of different emotions, and I had so much fun with this, and I can't wait to go back and watch it again now.
Yeah.
And it just
the show was so exciting, but at the same time, this is the most comfortable. A Doctor Who's comfortable again.
Yes.
Well,
it's nice.
It feels back.
It feels back to me.
It feels kind of weird to say, because Chibnall, he didn't do as bad as a job as people say he did. But like,
he's
again, there's no guarantee. There's no guarantee that RTD is just going to fix everything.
Right. I mean,
you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. Everyone's just going off this first episode and saying, okay, everything's back. Let's go.
I'd like to know that if Chibnall had been given the time, energy, and budget that they're given Russell.
Right.
And if they had not tied Chibnall's hand,
mm-hmm.
what would we have gotten? Because we know that Jodie Whittaker is a amazing actress, and that it could have been, instead of being in kind of the average, being somewhere floating between B grades and D grades and C grades and floating in there. And I know some of the individual storylines people didn't like, but it could have been better. Could have been edited better. We definitely felt things were missing, and now we know that things were missing because he wasn't given the time.
Yeah.
Some of those series were supposed to be multiple episodes, and they were cut down to
because of COVID. Episodes. They were cut down to 6 episodes.
I know.
Now, this is interesting. A lot, and I Doctor Who was not doing as bad as everyone says. There are people who go, people are going, oh, the show would have been canceled if Russell hadn't come back.
I don't think so.
You know why they wouldn't have? Because BBC was looking for streaming services before they hired Russell.
Yes.
So they were planning to continue it with whoever was going to run it. They knew Chibnall was leaving, but they were going to continue it. They wanted to do it.
One of those stories that, and in this day and age, with the way that things are done in social media, you create a narrative and you get people salivating, and you get people going, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, and until something blows up so that everyone's going, now it's great, now it's wonderful, now it's perfect. And everyone forgets all the good bits that were behind them and everything that worked that was behind them. And it wasn't that bad. It wasn't horrible. It shouldn't be forgotten.
No.
It shouldn't be erased. It needs to be part of the story. It needs to be, you know, hey, if you didn't like it, that's fine. There's always doctors that those of us, I mean, come on. How long have we been bashing 8? Come on.
How long have we been bashing Colin? I mean, not me, but a lot of people, they used to bash Colin. Sylvester's fault that the show ended. It wasn't.
No, that wasn't it at all. There are so many other things, and that's what it is people like sound bites, and they like short answers.
Yeah.
And so it's just, we've entered another phase, and you know, now he's got the budget, he's got some great talent, he's got some great writers. So I think in some ways, he's going to be lucky. Well, we already know he's going to be luckier than Chibnall ever was. He's going to have a lot more options.
Yeah.
And he's got the budget. He's got the marketing. Because even if Disney's not doing it, we already know that the BBC is marketing the hell out of this thing.
Russell is saying that it's actually harder to write for a bigger budget.
It is actually.
Yeah. Well, I can imagine.
Because there's so much writing on you. And it's kind of the story that, you know, you can have what they call sleeper hits, where you're not spending a lot on the budget. You can still have big name talent, but oftentimes not, or they're, you know, they're just a little bit in a film or something. And everyone's like, oh my God, this is a great film. And it just, it's amazing. And look at all this money it made. But of course, the budget was like a tenth of what maybe what an MCU or a DC movie is. And it's like, well, but of course, it made 10 times its budget, which is still a fraction of what a Marvel movie may make.
Yeah.
But that's because it also wasn't big budget. Big budget always means more pressure, more... I mean, the entire world is on your shoulders. So you always have to, you have to feel a little... nervous for Russell, because he is going to be expected, especially now. I purposely tried to avoid as much of what's out there on this until after we're done with our show.
Right.
But what little bits that seeped through my social media stuff that I couldn't get away from was everyone is like us. Oh my God, this is really great. Well, the poor guy's now got to make sure that he's at an A level every single time.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's hard. If he slips to a B, oh my God, he's failing.
You know, everyone, you know, oh, Russell T. Davis was the greatest, the God. There were some, during the Russell T. Davis era, there were people going, oh, this episode sucked. He sucks. Get someone else. That it's just, that's what people do. So Russell coming back, the second coming back, he's going to make some mistakes. He can't. No one's perfect. There are going to be some bad episodes. There are going to be some stinkers. This wasn't. Starbeast was not a stinker.
No, it was not.
No.
But like, I want to say, like, it's literally unfair to like a writer or showrunner where you've already rebuilt or brought back a show and expect to make lightning strike twice again.
Yeah.
Like, whatever comes, I think should just come.
Yeah.
Because, like, even if RTD doesn't strike lightning twice, I'll be honest, no one with realistic expectations would have expected him to strike twice the same way he did through 2005 to 2010. It's probably almost impossible to hit those heights again.
But it'd be cool to try. It'll be cool for him to try.
Look, he's trying, at least from what I see.
He's done some really good shows. He's developed his writing prowess much more now. I mean, he did It's a Sin, Nolly. He did, there are so many shows he's done since 2010, which definitely have made him grow as a writer. So I think coming back to this, he's a better writer than he was before. Whether...
Right.
It works again. I think it will. But he's a different person than he was 13 years ago. Different writer than he was 13 years ago.
Right. But I do want to say this, though. And I want to talk about the comic for a second.
We're going to bring up the comic. I'm going to bring up the comic, yeah.
Okay. Even though this adaptation was really, really good, I personally feel like they left out the cooler... elements of the comic. Like, the first part has to do with the Doctor being converted into a human bomb, and
that was
and on the Rarth using him to get to the Meep or Meep the Meep. And I read that, I was like, oh wow, if they're going through with that, at least from what I saw from the trailers, it looked like they was going straight down that path, because you saw the
They couldn't. They couldn't because they had to. They had to intertwine
family stuff.
The whole show. Did you notice Sergeant Zogroth and Constable Zrieg? They were in both the comic and the episode. I thought that was really cool. I'm like, I think those names sound familiar. So I did. I went back to my comic. I'm like, oh, because they are.
And I'm like, just grab the Doctor's head with your tongue hand thing. Just once. That's all I wanted to see, just to see this giant hand just come out of this guy's mouth and just grab the doctor's head. Like, yeah. Wow, that's unexpected. But hey, the episode still ended up well. I get that he had to put in the Donna elements and tie in with the other stuff that's coming next. I overall liked it.
You give it an 8 point, whatever you said. And you said 9.8, Vicky?
Yep, I said 9.8.
I give it a 9.8 too. I really had no problem. I loved it. I would almost give it a 10, but you can't give it a 10 until you see what else is coming out. Then maybe a retroactive 10. I give it a 9.8 as a placeholder. Let's see what the other episodes do. You brought up the comic strip. Go ahead, Zion. Because I don't think Vicky's read this. You've never read the comic.
I have not read the comic strip. So Doctor Who, please tell me about it.
Doctor Who Weekly started in 1979 when Tom Baker was a doctor. It was from Marvel UK. It had comic strips. It had text stories. It had informative information, nonfiction stuff, like a review of an episode that you'd never seen because it was years ago and they don't have a copy of it anymore. And it was a really cool magazine. And in the first, I think it was 20, what was it, 30, possibly 32 issues, 33 issues, Pat Mills and John Wagner, both of 2000 AD, John Wagner, the guy who created Judge Dredd. We actually interviewed John Wagner on Mark. Go, this is your homework assignment, folks. Go to Mark Who 77. It's on the 77 Publications YouTube channel. And you can look for the episode with John Wagner. Because in that episode, we talk a little about Doctor Who. But they were both writing for it. And they both came up with the stories, and then there were two stories that Pat wrote, two episodes that John wrote. And The Star Beast was one of the episodes that Pat Mills wrote.
Yeah, it is essentially overall the same story, except that the Doctor lands on the Rarth ship because he hit the randomizer.
Yeah.
And they catch him, knock him out, operate on him, put a bomb in him because they think that he's a spy for the Meep, have him go away, and then the whole story kind of like unfolds like how the story did, except that Rose is I can't remember her name.
Sharon.
Right? And so essentially the same thing happens. Sharon takes a liking to Beep the Meep. And
Fudge had a bigger part than Fudge had in this episode.
Yes.
Yeah, the character Fudge was in both, folks.
And essentially, the first story ends on a cliffhanger where the Rarth are about to detonate the bomb. But the whole thing unfolds essentially the same way, even with the sun, except the psychedelic sun. It's called the Black Sun.
The Black Sun. Radiation from the Black Sun. So radiation from the Black Sun turned him into conquering savage beasts. Beep was shot down from his escape from the Battle of Yarrus. Isn't Meep the last Beep? I think
yes.
Because he killed all the other Meeps. Beeps. Meep the Beeps. No. Other Beeps, didn't he?
No, it was the Wars.
Okay, it was the Wars. But I
the council of whoever ran the star systems called the Wars because they're like the police force.
Right.
And they wiped out all of the Meeps.
The Wars were basically the Jadoon.
Yes.
Before they had to do. Yeah.
And he's the last one. And I forgot, like his ship was powered by a black hole, right?
Yes, there was a black hole that was going to suck
everything. And he was going to use it to
in the Earth's atmosphere. It had to be out to use the black hole drive. It had to be out in space to do. And Meep, because the engines weren't working, Meep was like, I'm killing everyone anyway. Let's take off from inside the atmosphere and destroy Earth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the doctor stops it. And instead of Rose just staying on Earth, Sharon actually becomes the companion.
Yeah, Sharon becomes the first black companion in Doctor Who.
Yeah, I read that, and that was really interesting.
Yeah.
I did not know that she even existed up until that point.
You know, the further adventures of Sharon and the Doctor you can find in issues of Doctor Who Weekly. But yeah,
the art is really nice, though.
Well, Dave Gibbons did the art. Watchmen. What else? Yes, it was good. It was good art.
Yeah. Yeah, what's that one page where the city is being sucked into the black hole? And in the background, you will see the Doctor straining from the gravitational influence.
Yeah.
And if you don't pay attention to the page, you can actually just miss it. But like it's right there, and like I'm looking at it, I'm like, wow, this looks really nice. And it's interesting now because it's the guy that did Watchmen.
What's
That
also
is
interesting,
wild.
it is. What's also interesting is that he's got Tom Baker down. There are
Yes.
other later in the Doctor Who magazine, Doctor Who Monthly, whatever. When they bring on Peter, when they bring on Colin, they only had a photograph to work from, and they were just some of them did not look very much like the actor.
Right.
Dave Gibbons has Tom Baker down.
Yes.
In fact, if they had the money, and now they can, I would have been cool to make these stories because they were very well written. They could have worked on the show proper, except they didn't have the cash. What did they do now? They had the cash. They made one of the stories. So we're going to go with the Iron Legion as the first story in Shudi's role, followed when he goes to Rome in an alternate universe that never fell. Yeah, well, that's going to happen in Shudi. No, it's not. But it would be cool. The Iron Legion was a great story. Canine was in it. Yes.
No. The funny thing about K9, K9 was malfunctioning. So every time that you saw him, he was putting out cat sounds.
Didn't the Rorf kind of screw him up? I think it was Rorf's fault that K9 was out of action for the rest of the story.
It might have been that.
I think so. Yeah, they attacked him and nothing else he could do. You need to see these, Vicky. Maybe I'll send you a copy of the issues because it's available if you can't find those weeklies, and because they can be expensive and rare. You can pick them up in there's the trade paperback that's coming out, I think, Fourth Doctor Classic Comics from it's going to have everything from the Doctor Who Weekly and Monthly with the Tom Baker character.
Interesting.
That'd
Yes.
be
But
fast watching.
I'll send you a copy of the strips because
Yeah, I want to see
they're
this.
really good. And maybe I'll give you all the Pat Mill John Wagners because they are definitely to read. They're definitely good stories.
Very good.
Okay, we're running close to the end of the show. Does anyone have any final moments to talk about of the Star Beast Destination Skaro or anything else we've talked about today?
I just, if you haven't seen it, watch it, and I can't wait to watch it again.
Me too.
I need.
I've watched it 2.5 times. Half a time? What does that mean? Yeah. Zion?
Dodge all next time trailers because I heard that the next episode is unlike anything we've ever seen.
Yes. Oh, and that's a good point to bring up. So Russell let people know the first story, the one we've seen, is for family. It's for children, for family, everyone. When we get to the second and third stories, they're more intense. They're more different that it may not be for children anymore. The first episode of the anniversary was for the children. Everything else is for people who can handle it. And you're right. He said the second story, which is Wild Blue Yonder, is unlike any Doctor Who story that's ever been made, and they don't want to give any spoilers for it. I unfortunately saw the 15-second trailer for it. No, not unfortunately. It's kind of cool. It looks very funny, but at the same time, very serious. And I don't know what the story is. I only know one scene that was funny. Everything else, I don't know. And that was included on Doctor Who Unleashed that was on last night too on BBC Three. I'm not going to tell you what it was, folks, but you're going to like the story. Just that one scene is good. Imagine the other 58 minutes. It's
Yeah.
going to be good. It's going to be good.
Okay.
And of course, then the third episode, The Giggle, which is the toy maker story with Neil Patrick Harris. That episode is going to be longer than the rest of the specials. All these specials, the first two are like 58 minutes. The third one will be like 1 hour and 5, hour and 10 minutes because there's a lot to fit in. So, yeah, and our
Yeah.
next show, I'm not sure if we're doing it directly after Wild Blue Yonder or if we're doing it directly after The Giggle and both episodes together like we kind of did today. I'm not sure what we're doing. We'll let you guys know on social media and, look out for us on Apple, I'm sorry, on, yeah, Apple Play. Is it Apple? Apple, iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, Spreaker, all the podcast platforms out there. You may want to look for us. We're under the name The Mark Who 42's Universe Podcast, which I guess you know because you're listening to it. So you must have found us. And we can't tell you to go directly from the radio show because we're not there right now. But on behalf of myself, Mark Baumgarten, Vicky Jakubowski, and Zion Quiros, we're going to say goodbye from all of you. Alonze. I guess we can say again now. And until next time. Oh, and do us a favor. Go to iTunes. Go to the Mark Who 42's Universe podcast. And please leave us a rating and a comment. Definitely go to markwho42.com. You've got all our old shows. and the Mark Who 77 links, so you can watch Mark Who 77 directly from our website. And finally, if you want to write us a comment, if you want to write us a letter so we can read it on the air, just tell us something you thought about the show, markwho42.42@gmail.com. So until next time, I'll say it again. Allons-y, bye everyone. You've been listening to the Mark Who 42's Universe podcast, or as it's simply known, Mark Who 42's Universe. Hosting the show were Mark Baumgarten, Vicky Jakubowski, and Zion Quiros. If you'd like to leave a comment for us, please email us at markwho42.42@gmail.com. Mark Who 42's Universe, copyright 2023.